Longevity in plants. There was an article in The Scientist called Mechanism Behind Extreme Longevity in Some Plants, subtitled Certain Plant Stems Rarely Divide, a study shows, possibly fending off an accumulation of potentially harmful genetic mutations in some species. And it's actually the notation is May 5 of 2016, and the paper is about the same time. This particular part is available in its entirety online. It starts out, compared to human century-long lifespan, some plants, evergreens in particular, have the capacity to live for an exceptionally long time, even millennia. The background of the slide is bristlecone pine. In a study published in Current Biology Today, that is May 5, scientists from the University of Bern in Switzerland present evidence for a potential mechanism that could help explain some plants' everlasting longevity, minimal stem divisions to avoid mutational meltdown. Now, remember that John Sanford doesn't know what he's talking about. The team zeroed in on, I'm sure that should be on, the formation of axillary meristems, stem cells that give rise to branches, presumably from meris, the Greek meris, meaning part. In Arabidopsis thaliana and tomato, finding few cell divisions between the apical meristem located at the very top of a plant and axillary meristems. With such little proliferation comes less opportunity to accumulate potentially deleterious genetic mutations in somatic cells that could kill the organism, the authors reasoned. I thought mutations were the raw material for evolution. Now, some of you go, tomato, I know that. Arabidopsis thaliana, what in the world is that? Well, that's what it is. It's a little plant, it's called thalecress, has little flowers and then little seed, long things that have seeds on them. And you can see that there are various branches here, here, here. Meristem aging is not a problem for perennial plants, in other words, said Sergei Munier-Bosch, a plant physiologist at the University of Barcelona, who is not part of the study. The meristems are the growing units. If they don't senesce, grow too old too fast, then the plant will keep the capacity to grow and reproduce forever, at least potentially. Instead, he added, structural defects or pathogens most often kill plants. In other words, they don't undergo mutational meltdown. That's because they were designed not to. The research team led by Chris Kuhlmeier, who studies plant development at the University of Bern, developed an imaging technique to track meristem cells over time. He found that cells from the apical meristem, that's the very top one, stem cells from which the axillary meristem forms, divided only 7 to 9 times before establishing the axillary meristem. In other words, they leave behind meristem stem cells that don't multiply very much before that happens. In tomato, Kuhlmeier said, it turns out all the cells around are making lots of cell divisions to make leaves and stems, but few cells are destined to become the axillary meristem. Those really don't divide. Now, that's their ellipsis, that's mine. It's a beautiful piece of work, Rob Lanfear of Macquarie University in Australia wrote in an email to the scientists. If the same is true in other species, the results suggest that most plants have something akin to the germline in animals, added Lanfear, who was not involved in the work. That is, plants seem to set aside some cells in such a way as to minimize the number of mutations they accumulate. Kuhlmeier and colleagues then extrapolated what they observed to predict how this would play out in the branches of trees. A mutation in an apical stem cell may get fixed in a resulting axillary meristem, and therefore in the branch that grows from the meristem. But the mutation would not spread to all branches of the tree because they arise from different meristems. So a tree is a collection of meristems, and each is genetically individual. Such biology allows a tree to maximize genetic heterogeneity among its branches. Perhaps one branch might have the ability to resist a pathogen while another succumbs to it. In such a way, a plant could develop a formidable lifespan. Now, that's assuming that those mutations make them better and better. Kuhlmeier said that his team's results must still be validated. Somebody else needs to repeat this. One project underway in Switzerland could lend empirical data to test the group's hypothesis. Philip Raymond of the University of Lausanne is heading up the Napoleon Project, an effort to sequence the full genome of a 238-year-old oak tree on campus. Or should I say genomes, because they're going to take different parts of it and check it out. Raymond's team has actually sequenced two genomes taken from different parts of the tree to see how many mutations are present and whether these distant sites share any mutations. So they're going to find out the genetic diversity within a particular tree. Whether this mechanism to limit somatic mutations was selected for evolutionarily to increase longevity or protect the germline remains an open question, and one that would be very tricky to answer, said Lanfear. Or maybe it was selected for both, only maybe it was not natural selection. To Newton's mind, it's possible the researchers' observations of the meristem constitute a mechanism for lifespan maintenance, but it is likely not the only mechanism. Well, duh. The relationship of mutation accumulation to aging and death is not clear. So, what is this article that's producing this interest in the community? Well, it's a Burian et al. In 2016, patterns of stem cell divisions contributed to plant longevity in current biology. And you can get the abstract for free. If you don't mind driving to La Sierra or getting an interlibrary loan, you can get the article itself. I'll quote the abstract. The lifespan of plants ranges from a few weeks in annuals to thousands of years in trees. It is hard to explain such extreme longevity considering that DNA replication errors inevitably cause mutations. Without purging through meiotic recombination, the accumulation of somatic mutations will eventually result in mutational meltdown, a phenomenon known as Müller's ratchet. So you get lots of mutations, it's actually bad for you. Nevertheless, the lifespan of trees is limited more often by incidental disease or structural damage than by genetic aging. The key determinants of tree architecture are the axillary meristems, which forms in the axils, which is why they're calling them axillary, the axils of leaves, and grow out to form branches. The number of branches is low in annual plants, but in perennial plants, iterative branching can result in thousands of terminal branches. Here we use stem cell ablation and quantitative cell lineage analysis to show that axillary meristems are set aside early, analogous to the metazoan germline. While neighboring cells divide vigorously, axillary meristem precursors maintain a quiescent state with only 7 to 9 cell divisions occurring between the apical and axillary meristem. During iterative branching, the number of branches increases exponentially, while the number of cell divisions increases linearly. Moreover, computational modeling shows that stem cell arrangements and positioning of axillary meristems distribute somatic mutations around the main shoot, preventing their fixation in the whole tree and maximizing genetic heterogeneity. That one actually isn't quite true, but we'll get into that. These features slow down Müller's ratchet and thereby extend lifespan. Mutational meltdown is a real concern to these people. You would never know it from your biology books, would you? Well, we're going to go through it. I'm not going to read the whole thing, obviously, but we'll go through a good share of it. I will apologize ahead of time if there are misspellings. What I had to do was take the paper copy, feed it in as a PDF into a program that did optical scanning, and then take the optical scanner and fix it. And I'm not sure I've done it completely, but I've tried. When a plant emerges from the seed, it is a simple structure: root, hypocotyl, cotyledons, and a shoot apical meristem with a few true leaves. All further above ground cells, tissues, and organs arise post-germination as the descendants of the stem cells at the tip of the shoot apical meristem. The lifespan of a plant can range from a few weeks in annuals to hundreds of years in some slow-growing herbs, to thousands or even tens of thousands of years in trees. While the relationship between growth rate, aging, mortality, and reproduction are complex and different among plants and animals, the extreme longevity of large trees poses a particularly interesting conundrum. DNA replication errors are a main source of mutations, and indeterminate growth will cause the accumulation of somatic mutations with each cell cycle. Without purging through recombination, which the cells can't do because all they can do is mitosis, the accumulations of deleterious mutations will eventually cause mutational meltdown, a phenomenon known as Müller's ratchet. Well, this isn't what you heard in biology, is it? The key determinants of tree architecture are the axillary meristems, which form in the axils of leaves. They develop into axillary buds, which can grow out and form branches. In response to developmental and environmental signals, I'm sorry, this should not be capitalized. It kept capitalizing the I's, and that's one I missed. Branches in response to developmental and environmental signals, and that should be a period as well. During bud outgrowth, the axillary meristem becomes the apical meristem of the branch. So what happens is that it grows up, there's another growth center, and then that one grows out and behaves just like the top one, only going out to the side. Let me just make this a little easier for you to see. You have I've left out the underground stuff. You have a rod going up. At the very tip of it are some stem cells that keep giving rise to other cells. But don't multiply very much themselves. They tend to multiply, and then the next bunch that they divide into tends to multiply a lot. And those are called meristems. And in particular, since this is the one at the very top, this is the apical meristem. Now, you grow that tree a little bit longer, and you still have the apical meristem, but now you have leaves that come out, either together or staggered, it doesn't matter. And right in the middle, there's some things called axillary meristems. You keep growing it a little bit further, and those leaves will fall off, and in the meantime, you still have the apical meristem continuing to grow the plant or tree. But now you have the axillary meristems as if they're creating their own tree. And of course, there are, again, more leaves with more axillary meristems. And on the branches, there will be leaves with their axillary meristems. And the process just keeps going. In the leaf axils of the branch, secondary axillary meristems form that can grow out into secondary branches. The number of branches is low in annual plants. You saw Aerodopsis, only a few branches there. But in perennial plants, iterative branching can result in thousands of terminal branches. Thus, branching is comparable between annuals and perennials, the main difference being the number of iterations. Knowing the number of cell divisions separating the embryonic meristem from the terminal branches is crucial to determine the rate of genetic aging. This number is the number of cell divisions between an apical and an axillary meristem multiplied by the number of iterations. That is, how many times do you have to multiply to get the axillary meristem? And then, of course, each one of those does the same thing. The number of iterations can be estimated with reasonable accuracy. You just count the branches on the tree. For example, assuming regular bifurcating branches, 10 iterations will give 1,024, or 2 to the 10th, terminal branches. 1K for those of you computing. In reality, branching will be less regular as it will depend on environmental, physiologic, and genetic factors. Sometimes it won't make a branch in that particular area. However, in principle, the exact topology of the branching system can be determined in any individual tree. The number of cell divisions between apical and axillary meristems is not known, or at least was not known until this thing is published. And of course, they've made some attempt to answer that. We consider three possible models, figure one, which we'll show you in a minute. In model one, axillary meristems derive from differentiated shoot cells, just any old differentiated shoot cells, either of the internode or the leaf. That's called late specification of axillary meristem. These differentiated cells undergo multiple cell divisions during elongation of the internode or outgrowth of the leaf, whichever it happens to be. In this model, the number of cell divisions between the apical meristem and the terminal organs correlates with plant stature, how tall the plant is, and will become very high in big statured plants as favored by population geneticists. I'm not sure how that last phrase should be interpreted. I assume that means that this theory is favored by population geneticists. And here's figure one, and you can see maybe this is the apical that just keeps growing and growing up. Maybe this little area here, any of these cells will work, and it doesn't matter. And it does produce eventually an apical meristem, but there's multiple divisions before you get there. Model two assumes that everything just keeps multiplying, and so does the stem cell. And model three says, no, actually what happens is you have a few branches and then the stem cell goes quiet while the rest of the plant multiplies around it. Now, this one obviously will have fewer generations between the apical meristem and the axillary meristem. Models 2 and 3 take into account that cell division ceases during the formation of the boundary between the leaf primordial and the apical meristem, the position of the future leaf axil. And that gene expression studies indicate that separate identity of the boundary. Note, however, that the formation of an axillary meristem is delayed relative to the formation of the subtending leaf. In An Arabidopsis, that's commonly studied plant. This delay can be as much as 11 plastocrons, that is, the first anatomical indication of axillary meristem formation, the first little bud that comes out, occurs in the axil of a leaf that has already 10 younger leaves above it on the stem. So it's leaf, 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 and finally you start getting the branches. The patterns of cell division during those 10 plastocrons are not known. They just keep multiplying, or do they stop? In model 2, we assume that the cells in the leaf axil engage in cell division until a few of them develop into an axillary meristem, and that axillary meristem specification is position dependent. It just happens to be at the right place, so that's the one that takes off. If this is correct, the number of cell divisions between the apical meristem and the terminal organs, again, correlates with plant stature, as in model 1. And of course, if you're talking about a redwood, we're talking 365 feet. Model 3 assumes that the cells in the leaf axil retain their quiescent stature until axillary meristems are formed, and that axillary meristem specification is lineage dependent. In this model, the number of cell divisions between apical and axillary meristems will be low and not related to plant stature. Well, technically it will be, but it will be related to the log of plant stature rather than plant stature itself. Therefore, key questions to be answered are whether axillary meristems are specified at the same time as a subtending leaf. Is this a special cell? And number 2, whether progenitor cells of axillary meristems maintain a quiescent state. Do they just sit there and not divide until it's time? Chimerism appears to be a common in plants, especially long-lived trees should be considered not as single organisms, but as colonies of competing branches. I read that and I thought, what? I thought the branches were cooperating branches, but whatever. The width of the widest clonal sectors suggests that 1 to 3 stem cells contribute to the circumference of the stem. Their length suggests that stem cells are not permanent. So the stem cells, even though they are, well, semi-permanent, they are not completely permanent. Here we use surgical manipulations and quantitative cell lineage analysis in Arabidopsis. That got spelled wrong. And tomato to show that axillary meristem specification occurs at the shoot apical meristem concomitant with leaf initiation. That as soon as a leaf gets started, there's a special cell that's set apart. And that the number of divisions in the cell lineage from the shoot apical meristem to the axillary meristem is reduced in comparison with the cell lineage leading to differentiated cells. So there's a whole bunch of almost differentiated cells that multiply, but there's one that's kind of saved there just for the purpose of, or maybe 2 or 3, just for the purpose of being able to make this new stem with fresh genetic material, or saved genetic material if you prefer. We use the quantitative data to generate a computational model that recreates the patterns of cell division from the stem cells in the shoot apical meristem to the stem cells in the axillary meristems. The realistically modeled cell lineages indicate that stem cells persist at the shoot apex. This stem cell behavior prevents fixation and instead maximizes genetic heterogeneity, which will become more pronounced with increasing age. We extrapolate our data from Arabidopsis and tomato to long-lived trees. The tree growth habit has evolved in numerous plant lineages. In other words, not all trees are related to each other, and some of them are related to herbs. Thus, notwithstanding differences in important developmental details, early sequestration of axillary meristems and semi-permanence of apical stem cells are conserved features of seed plants. They all have them. Results in discussion: axillary meristems are specified early If axillary meristems are specified early, their progenitor cells should be merited by specific gene expression. You're looking at plant hormones. To develop the origin of the cells incorporated into the axillary meristem, we perform time-lapse imaging in vegetative Arabidopsis apices expressing the auxin response reporter DR5-Venus. So there's this hormone that they're looking at. DR5-Venus is not expressed at the I3 stage, but expression is apparent 23 hours later in the future boundary, or the leaf axil, and is maintained at the boundary during primordium bulging. And that's 1 and 2 days later. Thus, even though axillary meristems develop as much as 11 plastocrons after the subtending leaves, DR5-Venus expression marks the position of the future axillary meristem and not the position of the leaf. There's a hormone that marks that specific spot. This applies to the vegetative phase, but also after the transition to flowering. So this mechanism keeps the genes fresh not only for the leaves, but also for the flowers, which is kind of important if you think about it, because the flowers are what are going to pass on the genes to the next generation, and you want them to have few mistakes as well. And this is figure 2, and this has to do with the curvature of the particular area. This has to do with one of the hormones in here. You can see the side view of the hormone, and you can see it's concentrated in a particular area here. The text will make more sense of that. This is the kind of thing that you're not going to be able to just look at and move on, but if you spend some time studying it, you can understand what they're looking for. If axillary meristems are specified early, their further development must be inhibited. So they have to, you know, tell them to stop multiplying until it's your time. It has been hypothesized that the center of the vegetative meristem is a source of an inhibitor of the formation of axillary meristems. Other people have thought this is a good idea. To test this hypothesis, we ablated the central zone and followed the development of ablated APCs by time-lapse imaging. Ablation eliminated expression of the stem cell markers CLV3-GFP. And there's some more pictures that are, again, you really have to kind of study them to understand them. However, development of existing and incipient leaf primordia continued. So they still kept growing leaves, showing that ablation does not inhibit growth per se. After ablation, expression of CLV3-QFP marked the induction of stem cells that developed into meristems. This is a hormone that encourages the formation of meristems. Stem cells on this little thing that's going to turn into a branch. Clonal analysis showed that the cells of such induced meristems were recruited from the region expressing OR5-Venus adjacent to the incipient leaf primordium. Thus, these meristems can be considered as prematurely initiated axillary meristems. In summary, we conclude that in the intact vegetative shoot apex, the formation of axillary meristems is delayed due to inhibitory effect from the central zone, whereas the specification is an early event that occurs at the shoot apical meristem concomitant with leaf initiation. When the leaf is made, one or two or three cells are set aside to make the new branch eventually. This is inconsistent with model 1, but consistent with models 2 and 3. Now they're going to discuss the difference between model 2 and 3. The number of cell divisions in cell lineage leading to the axillary meristem is reduced in comparison with differentiated cells. The average cells just keep dividing. These cells, until they're ready to quit, these cells wait to divide until it's time to bring the new branch on. In order to determine the patterns and numbers of cell division between the apical and axillary meristem, we performed cell lineage analysis in both Arabidopsis and tomato. Note that all the data presented here concern the protodermal, or the L1 layer, that's the very outside, but that it is likely that our conclusions will also be valid for the internal layers. Unlike Arabidopsis, which forms, that should be comma, which forms a rosette of leaves, axillary meristems in tomato are separated from the apical meristem by elongated internodes. If axillary meristems derive from quiescent cells, then the number of cell divisions in the cell lineage leading to axillary meristems in tomato should be similar to Arabidopsis. However, if axillary meristems derive from repeatedly dividing cells of an internode or a leaf, this number should be increased in tomato. That's partly because tomato has a bunch of leaves at the same place, whereas Arabidopsis are one on each side. In Arabidopsis, we analyze cell lineages at shoot apices, starting from the vegetative phase until the early reproductive phase. First, we identified a population of 13 to 15 stem cells at T0 as a reference for our analysis. And in their figure 4, they've outlined that in magenta. And they're basically showing a particular hormone that helps form apical meristems. Within this stem cell population, we recognized a subset of 3 or 4 cells that we name apical stem cells. These cells retain their position at the meristem center during prolonged live imaging and thus are semi-permanent. Not completely permanent, but yeah. An attribute that has important consequences, as will be discussed below. The apical stem cells slowly divide. Is it out now? There. The apical stem cells slowly divide to give rise to an apical stem cell and a subapical stem cell. The latter further divides to provide precursors for new organs. So that multiplies a lot, but the stem cells themselves kind of save themselves and only multiply slowly. During early reproductive phase, Arabidopsis axillary meristems become morphologically recognizable at the, that means you can tell by the way they're shaped, at the boundary of leaf primordia up to 60 millimeters from the apical meristem center. And that's 171 and 214 hours in their figure 4. The number of cell divisions counting from the population of stem cells at the apical meristem at T0 to the axillary meristems is around 4 to 8. So they divide 4 to 8 times, and then that one is set aside. And then the tree keeps, or the plant, maybe a tree, maybe a small plant, keeps on growing and growing and growing. And then the next time you have a leaf, it'll deposit another set of special stem cells that don't multiply very much. For comparison, the number of divisions in cells that form both form leaf primordia is usually higher than that. In tomato, axillary meristems are morphologically recognizable approximately 300 to 550 microns from the apical meristem center. That is several times more than in Arabidopsis. Due to this large distance, it was technically difficult to continuously follow cell fates from the apical to the axillary meristem in tomato. So they divided this job into two parts. They analyzed lineages from the population of stem cells at the apical meristem to the boundary of a leaf primordium, and then they had to pick up another different leaf primordium at a similar developmental stage to the axillary meristem. So they followed it in two stages. As in Arabidopsis, we identified in tomato a population of stem cells outlined in magenta in figure 5, with a subset of 3 to 4, rarely 5, semi-permanent apical stem cells. So it's doing the same thing. It's putting these things aside to be used later. Similar numbers of apical stem cells have been found also in other species. The number of cell divisions counting from the stem cell population to the boundary is 4 to 8, which is about the same as it is for Arabidopsis. Next, from the boundary to the axillary meristem, there occur 1 to 3 cell divisions. So there's probably 11 divisions there for tomato. Well, 5 to 11. Further cell divisions increase the size of the axillary meristem. During this stage, the frequency of cell divisions in the inner node is much higher. At T plus 192 hours, 6 to 8 divisions in the inner node and 2 to 3 divisions in the axillary meristem. This higher mitotic activity in the internode, together with an intensive cell elongation, accounts for the increase in the distance between the apical meristem and the axillary meristem. So basically, a tomato divides a little bit more, but not much. Thus, most cell divisions involved in axillary meristem occur between the center and the boundary of the apical meristem. As soon as a cell reaches the boundary, the mitotic activity is reduced, and only few cell divisions are needed to establish a functional axillary meristem. Therefore, our results support model 3 in figure 1, which we saw earlier, and are in agreement with previous studies in maize showing that cells of the apical meristem undergo a progressive restriction of cell developmental commitment. The early specification and low rate of subsequent cell division are reminiscent of the germline in metazoans. And we propose that similar, the cells of the axillary meristems are set aside early, reducing the accumulation of replicative errors. The conservation of the mechanisms of axillary meristem development makes it possible to extrapolate our quantitative data from annual plants to trees. Because tomatoes aren't strictly annual plants all the time. Making this extrapolation, 10 branching events from the embryonic shoot apical meristem will give rise to 1024, 2 to the 10th, 1K again, for computer geeks, terminal meristems, which according to the data presented here will each have undergone about 60 cell divisions. This number only doubles in a tree with a million branches. We went from 1,000 to a million, and so that's 120 cells, more or less. Or 120 cell divisions to get a million branch tree. In comparison, an estimated 30 to 50 cell divisions per generation occur in annuals, such as Arabidopsis or maize. It grows up in 1 year. Generally speaking, doesn't take that many cell divisions. 30 to 50 to get to the flowers. Patterns of stem cell divisions maximize genetic heterogeneity. Now, this one I've had a little trouble with. If apical stem cells were strictly non-permanent, as was assumed in earlier mathematical models, whichever cells happen to be there will just grow, the chance of fixation of a neutral mutation is 1 over n, where n is the number of cells. That is 33%, assuming 3 stem cells. Because the apical stem cells are instead semi-permanent, the chance of fixation will decrease. We tested the magnitude of the effect using computational modeling. The probability of fixation within the main shoot was approximately 0.15% for an apical stem cell mutation and essentially 0 for subapical stem cells. Thus, the chance of fixation of mutation within the main shoot is 20 times lower than previously calculated and in line with assumptions based on clonal analysis. So it looks to me like the heterogeneity is going down rather than up, but I don't know. You guys can look at it and comment afterwards. Similar geometrical considerations apply to the chance of your mutation to become fixed in axillary meristems. Same thing, one to three cells at the top mean that really if you don't affect the top cell, the rest of it doesn't matter too much. The chance of fixation in all axillary meristems is essentially zero, because you're not going to have the whole plant change just because there's a mutation in one branch. However, the chance of fixation in at least one axillary meristem is 61% when a mutation occurred in an apical stem cell and 38% when it occurred in a subapical stem cell. Even when new mutations in this branch meristem are not fixed, they have a high chance of fixed, not meaning made better, but fixed into the branch. They have a high chance of fixation in at least one second order axillary meristem. So it's, you have a mutation in the one that's producing a major branch, then all the minor branches that come from that major branch will be fixed that way. For non-neutral mutations, this will result in competition between branches. Competition between branches. That's an interesting concept. A tree will contain nested sets of mutations. The model predicts that the vast majority of somatic mutations will be present in small sectors and that most of them will not propagate into the gametes. This is equally true for non-replicative mutations, except that, for example, environmentally induced mutations will accumulate irrespective of whether cells divide or not. They spray this thing with 2,4-D or something like that, well, you probably get into some trouble. This difference also applies in short-lived annual plants and may explain the relative scarcity of replication-based mutations in Arabidopsis. When axillary buds are dormant for a prolonged amount of time, as often happens in trees, the proportion of replication mutations will decrease. Most of the mutations that you get will be from environmental radiation, something else, not from the actual process of replication itself. With time, somatic mutations will inevitably accumulate and cause aging-related defects. In humans, accumulation of somatic mutations with age is the primary cause of cancer. This is unlikely to be due to more efficient DNA repair. That should be DNA. DNA repair pathways are conserved between plants and animals, and plant stem cells are highly susceptible to DNA damage. Disordered growth in a plant is likely to be not that much better than it is in a human. Maybe a little bit better because it's all on one side and one branch, and if that branch gets eaten, why, then that's the end of that. Yet plant lifespan is limited more often by structural damage and incidental disease than it is by mutations. We propose that stem cell sequestration, meristem geometry, and intra-organismal competition delay mutational meltdown and thereby extend the lifespan of plants. Well, I would say more like kind of loss of competition from the mutated cells that no longer grow a stem. Now, some of you were here when we discussed the germline of C. elegans and how the stem cells multiply very slowly at the very beginning and then very rapidly afterwards, which maintains the germline in the best reasonable way of doing things. This is the same kind of thing in plants. The design of plants is such that the number of divisions of the stem cells is proportional to the log of the number of branches instead of the number of branches, which greatly decreases the amount of mutations in those branches. This happens by sequestering stem cells until they are needed. They're kind of set aside and everything else grows around them. Doesn't sound like very much competition, does it? It is difficult to understand how this system would have been stumbled across by an extremely nearsighted search system, such as mutations and natural selection. Note the frank admission that Müller's ratchet is deadly for organisms. Genetic entropy is real. Sanford was right. Trees growing to be very old have to fight against it. Beneficial mutations are few and far between. Otherwise, trees would not have to be so well designed to avoid mutations. Notice how carefully this is constructed to make few mutations. The system is not so much designed for, as they put it, maximizing genetic heterogeneity, as it is for preserving genetic purity. Note the repeated reference to competition. They've got to get evolution in there somewhere. Even though the whole point of the tree is cooperation of the cells to form an efficient organization. The deleterious effects of competition are even recognized by the authors when they say, quote, in humans, accumulation of somatic mutations with age is the primary cause of cancer. You don't want those mutations. Competition between seeds could conceivably be healthy. Competition within a plant is not. And natural selection may be a purifying force as much as, or more than, an encouragement to new varieties. Trees are meant to grow in a more or less symmetrical way, with not having bunches of branches that are trying new things, but rather they're trying the same old thing that they were programmed to do. Oak trees, spruce or pine, redwoods. Those are intended to be organizational wholes. And they're designed to minimize mutations. Now, you'd never know this without a considerable amount of background knowledge. The paper doesn't really tell you that. Scientific articles have to be read carefully, noting implications not emphasized by the authors. Don't take the conclusions of peer-reviewed articles at face value without checking them out. And finally, if somebody waves an article in your face, don't surrender without a careful reading. They may be not understanding the implications of the article itself. It's happened to me several times. You read the article carefully and it refutes what they're trying to tell you it is. But that's my opinion. Now it's your turn.
This is a marvelous confirmation of Sanford's work. I mean,
you wouldn't know it reading the thing until you start realizing what Müller's ratchet is and mutational meltdown.
Why don't you take a second to tell the group what Müller's ratchet is? That it's where mutations are tied together.
Well, what Müller's ratchet is in any mitotic cell, that is a cell that divides in two and takes the same DNA and splits it into two different cells. Okay, and that's true for all of, you know, everything except for sexual recombination. So for trees, we're talking about everything except the flowers or pine cones or whatever there is at the end. Okay? You have something that splits, and there's a goof in that one cell that wasn't in the parent and is probably not in the daughter cell. From then on, that cell always has that goof. And when it divides, it gives both cells its goof. And then if there are more goofs that keep happening, those ones keep... And so what happens is that the genetic mechanism gradually accumulates more and more genetic errors. And eventually, if you have enough genetic errors, the cell can't survive. Either specific kinds of errors that just wipe out a necessary enzyme, or perhaps an accumulation of several where any one of them isn't enough, but you know, the cumulative effect is enough to kill the organism. And it doesn't matter whether it's bacteria or plants or humans. And you can actually see this in a few humans that is visible. You'll see people with a patch of silver hair in otherwise black or blonde or redhead or whatever, and there's just this one little patch of silver hair. That area, when it got to dividing to form that area, lost the enzyme to make hair color. Well, that's a mistake. It's an attractive mistake, but it's a mistake nevertheless. And if that kind of process gets in the germline, then the kids wind up with the same, they turn albino. Okay? But even in humans, you can see this. Well, you can see that a plant that's growing, you know, thousands, millions of times can't afford to have a problem here and a problem there and a problem somewhere else. And so it very carefully protects its germline from those kinds of errors by having exquisite proofreading stuff when it does multiply, and by taking the care that the plant that is being produced has as few cell divisions as possible between the original cell and the tip of the stem, so that when it's growing, you have as few mutations as possible there. And that's the protection that is being demonstrated here against Müller's ratchet and mutational meltdown. Is that?
Yeah, and the fact that maybe one mutation out of 1,000, or more likely one out of 1,000,000 is beneficial.
The actual mutation rate for beneficial mutations is so low it has not been measured.
And the fact that half of your mutations are probably harmful tells you this tremendous degeneration factor we're facing here when you're dealing with Müller's ratchet. You're just fighting a losing battle.
But you can fight for a long time if you're careful. Well, and that's what trees do. They fight very carefully.
You know, I'd be interested in knowing the apical meristem of a redwood tree, top cells, up to how old those are. Some of these cells must be very old because they've reproduced so slowly compared to the rest of the tree. I'm just curious.
Well, if it's a redwood, it could be as high as 2,500 years or so.
I just wonder if some of those cells are that old. Yeah, I mean, it's interesting concept here. But
the other thing that's interesting is it doesn't just have one apical meristem cell. Because that way, if one of them gets mutated in such a way as to be completely damaging, the other two just take over.
These folks are walking right into a creation model. I mean, when they recognize, they're recognizing.
Well, certainly a design model.
Yes,
yeah.
And
if you understand the implications of mutational meltdown, it has to be a creationist model because they can't be that old. Unless God continually comes in and fixes things. And I thought the whole point of doing this is to get God out of the picture.
How did organisms ever survive without this protective system is a question you could ask.
And how do they survive for millions of years? Hundreds of millions of years.
That's especially difficult.
Your dialogue leads to my question. So if for the tree you have this sequestration and protection of the stem cell, let it last for thousands of years. What about annuals? Does annual actually have that mechanism, you know, the stem cells and protects them? I know that you said it's the proportion, the division of the stem cell is sort of indirectly proportional to the division of the stem. So these pretty fast growing, but they're annuals, or mm-hmm. even perennials, just live for a few years. So are there a protection mechanism or the sequestration of stem cell mechanism? Assume they have the buds and they have the stem cells uh-huh. too, uh-huh. but they're so short-lived. Now, is that because an evolutionary process that made them lost it? From the very origin, they were invented or they were created to live a long time and then they just kind of live shorter and shorter, or they were created to live that short?
I don't know the answer to that, but I can tell you this, that we know, actually we know more that it's true in the short-lived plants than we do in the long-lived plants. Arabidopsis is an annual. If you're very lucky and you have just the right climate, it could conceivably be a perennial for maybe 2 or 3 years. Same way with tomatoes. And those are the ones they actually studied. One of the things that should be done is somebody should repeat this in redwoods. Because the fact of the matter is, to be strictly honest, we're extrapolating from Arabidopsis, which is an annual, to the perennials. And we're betting it's the same mechanism. Now, it's a pretty good bet. But the fact of the matter is, where we know it's true is in the annuals. Yeah, well, but we're working on it. We're working on it. That's why one of the reasons why I think that confirmation of this kind of thing is kind of important. And, of course, the other reason is because science is the study of the reproducible, and you can't reproduce it, then it's not really science.
You're going to leave a lot of science out of that.
Well, you know, the fact of the matter is that the historical science is really science that leaves testable traces. That's what historical science really is.
It's hard to reproduce the Big Bang, you know.
It's hard to reproduce the Big Bang. Well, it's some argument that that maybe the Big Bang is just simply the furthest back extrapolation we can make if there's no creation in the meantime. And maybe it's not actually valid. I mean, maybe if we have a video of the universe, it wouldn't actually look just like the Big Bang. The interesting thing is that if you extrapolate it back, it doesn't extrapolate back forever. And that really bothered some people.
I think science is entitled to postulate explanations.
Oh, well, as long as it doesn't insist on them. You know, what you really need to establish a Big Bang would be video. And we don't have any of that, at least right now.
That's what I understand.
There was a statement, somatic mutation in humans with age cause cancer.
Yes. If you mutate the wrong thing and your P53 disappears and then your BRCA1 gene goes haywire, then you wind up with breast cancer.
Yeah, but you look at, so therefore if that's true, solely that's the thesis, then anyone who is 90 to 100 years old is in trouble? Or is it really outside factor? Is it the environment? Is it the what people are eating? That's
well, the story that I understand is that we actually all get cancer.
Yes, that's true.
Maybe
so.
About
all
20, 30 times a month.
Yes.
And what happens is that our immune system says, hey, that doesn't belong there, and kills it.
Yes.
And so we're fighting a battle that most of the time we win and occasionally we lose.
But what I understand is that statement is being made, well, if you are up in age, you're going to die because of the cancer within you. It's a somatic mutation that's killing you. I'm not sure.
There are people who live to be in their 90s without having cancer.
That is correct.
Well, it's true that there is some environmental influence.
That is correct. Yes.
You know, if you smoke, you probably put yourself at 3 or 4 times the risk. If you
you're
eat meat, your colon is taking a beating, and eventually it's likely to complain.
Yes.
And so, yeah, I mean, there are things that you can do to decrease the risk for it. And like I say, just getting cancer doesn't mean that you die. Most of the time your body gets rid of it and you never even know it.
No, that is correct.
Yeah. But, you know, if you suppress the immune system, I mean, there's all kinds of things you can do to kind of make it more likely that the cancer will grow.
Our health is our choice.
Not always. Well, our health is not entirely our choice.
Yeah. Well,
in modern times, we don't have any 130-year-olds.
If we look hard enough, we'll probably find them.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is that we're a long ways from 500 years, and obviously trees can beat that.
You remember Hunza land in Himalaya mountains? Adventists from Loma Linda used to go there, and they were living 130 years easily till they built a highway through there. You know, Nauru Islands, remember that, Nauru? Yeah, they were all living very healthy for a long, long time till they found phosphorus in the island, and everyone was put on welfare, whatever. But anyways, now within one generation, 40% of people are diabetics. How is that happening? You know, I mean, you and I all know that environment plays a big factor.
Of course. You look at the Pima Indians in the United States. And, you know, the average age of gallbladder out is 17 in females.
Yeah.
The people across the river in Mexico who are not on welfare at all continue to live to their standard lifestyle. So, yeah, lifestyle makes a big difference.
Yeah. Certain kinds of people in this country, all you need to put is your ultrasound probe on their liver and see their fatty liver. You don't even look at that. I mean, you look at them and you could tell that they have it.
Well, I have a joke that I give scenarios on people who, I teach advanced cardiac life support, and so this patient is going to get into trouble, and so I give them a scenario, and I tell them this patient has a very rare combination of diseases, diabetes, hypertension, and hypercholesterolemia, and I always get a good laugh out of that. Because half their patients have that.
That's right, if not more. So anyway, when you know that statement was repeated a couple of times, even the last, I think it was that sentence. So I thought I'd ask you. I think it's more.
Well, the point of it is that at present, we don't live forever. At present, we can make a great deal of difference, but we don't have that totally under our control.
It'll never be too...
You know, the promise is that there will come a time when that will be totally under our control. But that time is not now. But I think that the interesting point is that here the trees are designed to avoid mutations. And all your life in biology class, you are taught that mutations are the raw material of evolution. Well, shouldn't we have a few more of them? Evidently not.
And in humans, I don't think there's one, even one, beneficial mutation.
Well, there are some that are beneficial in certain circumstances, such as having hemoglobin S in one allele if you're in a malarial area.
Right, there you are.
But that's
but the consequences of it. You see, I mean, come on.
And I've dealt with the people who have both alleles, and it is not fun.
Well, you walk away with tears in your eyes from that room. You see, and you know that their days are counted. It's horrible.
Yeah, and the days that they do have are going to be miserable.
Yes, the sickle cell folk, you know, 13-year-old kid in the ER that you see, and you know that he's not going to last for too long. I mean, how could someone walk away from that room without tears in their eyes? It's horrible. It's horrible. So there's really nothing called beneficial mutation in human beings.
Well, it's like you say, there's sometimes when you burn your bridges in order to get somewhere, but those bridges were there for a purpose, and the burning of them is an act of desperation, not the creation of a new man.
I think an interesting sideline of this is that you know, we don't have, in the billions of years we have for life on Earth here, we don't have enough time for mutations have taken place and so on. We've got here a mechanism to slow down.
Exactly.
It adds a further problem to this time question for the amount of...
It just makes Haldane's dilemma that much harder.
Right.
Well, come back next week and we'll talk about Doug Axe and his book Undeniable. And then for those of you who want to look ahead, we'll be looking at some of the papers that he actually published in the peer-reviewed literature on primarily how small the target for a beneficial mutation has to be. So it's kind of related to what we're talking about today.